Good evening. I'm Terri Thornton, Curator of Education at the Modern Art Museum of Fort Worth, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to Being There, Revisiting Tuesday Evenings at the Modern, our online alternative to the museum's long-running lecture series. This is week five of what has been an enriching process for me, and I hope the same is true for those of you who have gathered around your computers at 7 p.m. on Tuesdays over the past 5 weeks. 5 weeks is kind of unbelievable, but it is starting to make a little more sense as I am learning a bit about myself through this process. Seeing where my attention has taken me is something of a revelation. As one of those who believes art is a salve and an instigator, I am glad to have the Tuesday Evening Archive to keep me in contact with ideas within that realm. Tonight is personal in some ways, but I think I can be objective in saying that this March 4th, 2014 presentation panel discussion relays a brilliant moment in a collaborative art practices, and as mentioned, illustrates art having the capacity both to disrupt norms and to heal what ails us. As you will see, Homecoming Project was an ambitious commitment and a wicked smart endeavor on the part of 12 or more artists during its run. This endeavor, in its own way, was a significant shot in the arm for the DFW Metroplex art communities. Revisiting it now reminds me of what we are capable of and gives me an appreciation for this region where we fight hard to keep life interesting and to find meaningful ways to engage. I'll be interested in getting your feedback. While the live chat, I'll be the first to admit, can be an awkward way to communicate, it's what we have. So jump in after the presentation if you want to exchange ideas on what we're about to see. So with that, let's get started. The front row is available if anybody wants to. If anybody's brave enough, I've told them they can't throw anything. And you can't throw things at them. And he has a camera. That's good. This is the one night I'll allow pictures. Somehow it seems appropriate to me. Okay, we'll make it official. Good evening to Tuesday Evenings at the Modern. I'm Terri Thornton, Curator of Education. I'm so happy you're here with us tonight. For those of you that are new to this lecture series, it's a weekly series running through April 8th this season. And I invite you to visit the Modern's website for the remaining schedule. We're a few weeks into it, and details on each of the presentations. In the 20 plus years of Tuesday Evenings, tonight is a first. We have a presentation tonight with 12 artists. We've never done that before. We've never even approached that. So we're making history. It's a case of great quantity and quality, as I have the honor and the pleasure of being in conversation with the Fort Worth-based, internationally relevant Homecoming Committee. I'm going to lay out a little bit about this band of 12 to catch up anyone new to their unique and profound endeavors. As described on their website, Homecoming is an assembly of artists and creatives who seek to develop collaborative projects in conjunction with their individual artistic production. As I understand it, the idea of such an assembly began as a conversation between two of the founders, artists Bradley Brown and Greg Ruppe, discussed the possibilities of this when Greg visited Bradley in New York. When Bradley Brown relocated from New York to Fort Worth for graduate school, the idea took form as the conversation grew to include artist Kris Pierce. Homecoming's first undertaking was a launch party in 2011 in an empty warehouse studio space on Weisenberger here in Fort Worth. The event was enthusiastically received by a large and diverse audience that spanned the Metroplex and seemed ecstatic, filled with curiosity and anticipation based on carefully managed conditions and information, all of which had been orchestrated by Homecoming. It was a program that embraced its DIY character, but was clearly something serious and enduring, a program that followers of Homecoming would come to expect.
Such ambitious, self-initiated projects events brought attention to this curious group of artists who were pulling off no small feat in producing art-centered happenings that had an inviting sense of folly, while clearly made of exhaustive research and tremendous attention to detail, all while maintaining their individual practices. For many, this is also while in the throes of graduate school. The attention they attained resulted in numerous articles in regional press, a strong and expansive online presence, and a move from self-initiated projects and spaces to invitations to show in established institutional spaces. Homecoming was a huge hit with their installation post-communique in the DMA's exhibition about Available Space, which showcased current activities and work of North Texas artists and curators. They were also invited to participate in the recent Texas Biennial, which is a statewide presentation of current trends in art in Texas. Such invitations are sure to continue as others strive to associate with the creativity and cachet of homecoming. While the group has had a few iterations in their 3 years to date, the current members are, as seated here, Timothy Harden, Devon Nowlin, Alden Williams, Shelby Meier, Ryan Goolsby, Greg Ruppe, Tiffany Wolf, Chris Bond, Kris Pierce, Courtney Hamilton, Bradley Brown, and Briana Williams. And they are here tonight, all here tonight, to offer insights into the formation, operation, and production of what was described by the Dallas Observer as a hive mind. A hive mind that produces thoughtful, smart, funny, participatory events, which have come to be anticipated by the DFW art community, experienced and appreciated by audiences within and outside that community, written about broadly, and puzzled over in a time when artists are looking for innovative models to practice and present, models of practice and presentation. So if you would, please join me in welcoming Homecoming Committee. Okay, the way this is going to work is I'm going to sort of set the ball rolling, and then either it will just take over and I will lose control and we'll just see what happens, or I will continue to push and prod these guys to give us answers. So we'll just see what happens. I don't think anybody will get hurt, but I'm not making any promises. All right, thank you guys so much for being here. I realize that it's a lot. While it might be nice to be asked to do something like this, the reality of it is it's a lot safer and easier to let the work speak for you and to not necessarily put yourself out on the line to do this. So I really do appreciate you all being here. And I also realize that some of you are probably more comfortable with this format than others. So I especially appreciate you being here. Okay. Did I have that right? Did homecoming really begin as a conversation between Bradley and Greg while visiting? Does that seem right?
I think so, yeah. I was up in New York for about 9 years and still keeping in touch with the Dallas art scene, keeping in touch with what was going on down here, still practicing artists, doing my independent thing, but kind of trying to live under this constant drive of being a creative in New York. Greg came to visit, and we kind of went down, did a little bit of reminiscing about going to undergrad together. Kris Pierce, Ryan Goolsby, and Greg, and Devon Nowlin, even though we didn't know her at the time, all went to undergrad at UNT. And we were really lucky, because it was an amazing time in that area, and there was a lot of creativity going on both in the art world and the music, and we all kind of grew up playing in bands. And I think that mentality, that band mentality, and getting a group together to do something creative really kind of pushed this idea of the collective into the mind of the visual art or the conceptual art or whatever we want to call it. So Greg came, visited, we reminisced, talked about a lot of things. I wanted to go to grad school, ended up coming down to TCU so we could kind of get the ball rolling on this. And then just got to meet a lot of really amazing artists who were working in the area, and you know, half of them were going to grad school, and Kris, Greg, and everyone kind of introduced me to each other, and we just started bonding and talking and drinking and having fun. And,
to develop in grad school it was a really good time to grow together, because I think that as probably a lot of you know, being in grad school, there's a camaraderie in the people that you meet, but there's also a constant competition, and I think that all of us working together and on sort of centralized projects really kind of reinforced a confidence in one another and a support for one another that was maybe not so available in the grad setting. So it was like a grad school of our own in a way, I guess.
Well, I was going to ask about that, you know, kind of what was the, what was the nature of this, you know, a group this large getting together and having a common idea, and was it, in fact, I know many of you actually have some affiliation with the TCU art department, so was it a matter of convenience? You knew each other through that setting, most of you, or was it that you were having the same kind of conversations because you were all in a place where that generally generates that sort of conversation of what's happening with art and what's our place in this, and you know, how do we distinguish ourselves, or whatever it is, whatever that conversation is. Does anybody want to talk about kind of coming into the group after?
I mean, I think like generally speaking, it wasn't like a super calculated thing. Like we decided we want to do this. I think Bradley came down from New York and had like kind of a different idea than we ended up sort of doing in the end. It was more, I think, calculated in the beginning, you know, like what really specifically, like what we wanted to look like and how we wanted to present ourselves and this kind of thing. And when people started to kind of jump on, it was just more or less about like hanging out. Nothing was really going on in Fort Worth at the time. I mean, since then there's been sort of an explosion of collectives and artists working and collaboration stuff, which is a really, really great thing. But like at the time, you know, Fort Worth is just far enough away from Dallas that it was just, you know, like nothing was happening. So it was kind of like we, you know, bonded and started to band together because we were all like-minded individuals, even though we maybe came from different backgrounds, and, you know, just started working on ideas, or, you know, more specifically like scheming on things that we could do to, you know, disrupt what was going on and give ourselves opportunities that we wouldn't have if we were just individuals in this town, you know, where not that much was really happening at the time, and still kind of isn't. So I think that was, you know, something that was like a huge motivator for like the group. You know, it was purely like fun, purely like motivated by having fun and just like, you know, drinking and staying up late, and purely motivated by like this sort of self-serving purpose to create opportunities for ourselves. You know, like no lie. So like
the power in numbers.
Yeah, and like for me, like it seemed really casual when it first started. It was very much like I got like a text from Bradley or Greg, I can't remember. They're like, hey, you should come meet us for a minute. And then I left whatever I was doing and ran over there, and they're like, we want to build a spaceship and we need a lot of people to do this. And I was like, that sounds awesome. Like, let me do what I can to help you, and we'll find as many people as we can to kind of get this project underway.
Okay, so it started with a spaceship.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, it's time.
I mean, for me, at least, that was my introduction. So, like,
time machine.
Okay.
This is what happens when you ask 12 artists to come.
I have. Big mistake. Good reason that this has never happened. Yeah.
I do think, though, the first project that we did, Launch Party, kind of was so much of the springboard for what came out of Homecoming. Mm-hmm. And we hit on a lot of different elements getting through this project that have carried on through other projects, but at the same time spurred us into several different directions. But mm-hmm. You know, I still have this really soft spot in my heart for this first event. I thought it was, you know, way more successful than I ever thought it could be, and was just kind of this idea where we were all kind of knew what we were going for, but everyone was still really confused the whole time. Mm-hmm. And,
well, including the audience.
Yeah,
including
everyone. And that moment that the space, we built it, we can go through the details, but we built it in this chamber so no one could see it while it was being built. And that moment that it unveiled, everyone, including all of us, were like, oh, I get it. Oh, okay, cool. That worked. And it was just, you know, this moment of clarity that, like, this has legs. This can actually do something. And, like,
yeah.
I didn't think anybody would show up for that thing.
No, yeah. I didn't
They paid, too.
They paid, yeah.
They paid money. They paid money to be there, yeah.
It was. I mean, the money we made from the first event ended up funding the next two. Mm-hmm. So it was great that we, you know, this idea of the crowdsourcing and just grassroots DIY funding really, it worked. I don't know.
Yeah. You know, just a description of what we did. I don't know if everybody knows, but
yeah.
We built a spaceship, if you want to call it that, on site from junk that people brought into the space. So there was like a cover charge, but you were discounted if you brought a piece of junk that we could fill the spaceship out of.
This was at the time when NASA was being disbanded in order to move space travel into a privatized realm. So our statement said that if we're going to get off this planet, we're never going to afford the $1 billion ticket. So we have to build the ship ourselves. So yeah, and then the audience participatory aspect of it was to invite people to bring materials in order to help us build the ship.
The statement, I mean, actually what they said, because this is really good. 2011, the planet Earth has become a hostile home, no longer tolerant of its toxic inhabitants, known as the human race. Global surface temperatures and carbon dioxide concentrations have skyrocketed, melting glaciers and the polar ice caps to overwhelm coastlines. The Earth has reached its breaking point. There's no going back. What are we going to do? We have to get the hell out of here. But how, you ask? Since NASA's Department of Spacecraft Development and Manufacturing has been eliminated, privatization has left us, the 99%, only dreaming of floating off this doomed planet into a final frontier. How will we ever beat those fat cats in this new space race? Okay, that is way too, to me, that is just, it's funny, but it's really smart. I mean, you obviously are keeping up with what's going on. I mean, you're just, I know that it's happening over drinks and that it's fun and that you might not even realize the seriousness of it until you get back from it. But I have a hard time buying that this doesn't, because there are patterns that I think as we move through tonight, everybody's gonna see. There are patterns. It's a little bit like you were saying, Bradley, that you did this and then you realized kind of what out of this you valued. And then I encourage the audience tonight to just look and see if you don't see these patterns picking back up throughout.
I think we like definitely have criteria that we sort of stick with whenever we're coming up with like an idea or putting together a proposal or whatever we're asked to do. And like being funny is definitely one of the criteria because I can't speak for the group, but like for me personally, I think that, you know, something that's funny or something based in comedy or whatever, it's like, it's disarming in some way. And especially if there's some sort of thought or idea that precedes like the comedy aspect of it, then I think that it's this sort of arc that like disarms the audience, you know, with the comedy. And then it sort of draws them into the more like intellectual idea that we have when, you know, we're sort of working on a project or whatever. So it's like a big part, keeping it interesting for ourselves too. So, but that's definitely like a big part of like the core of the group's ideas, I think.
Yeah, I think it's like largely part of the humor coupled with like the unknown. You know, the unknown of like setting yourself up for like the activity or the sort of interactivity with the individuals that come to the event, which is we're sort of like largely reliant on for the thing to be successful. Mm-hmm. So,
we don't know what's going to happen with anything that we do, honestly. Like, you know, we work up till the very second that something you know, that we do something, you know.
Literally.
Yeah. I mean, like at the DMA thing.
I find that interesting because up until you said that, this sounded to me like an individual artist practice. You think you have a plan, you set out to do it, but then there are surprises, which is the only reason any of us go back to make more stuff is because of those surprises. But the fact that you are kind of working up to that last minute. Can anybody else in the group sort of speak to that experience, what that feels like, and maybe how that's different than your personal practice? Does that feed your personal practice? Does it set you back and you can't go into the studio for a while?
I could speak that my practice with homecoming has in a lot of ways been a great supplement to my own artistic practice, and sometimes when the time that these projects take me away from my own practice, it's still it's all worth it. So I think it still fulfills a similar thing, an exploration.
Yeah, because when Kris is talking about like the humor, like everything we do, it is a lot of fun. But I think we wouldn't keep doing this if it was only fun. Mm-hmm. I think we do get a lot from it, because if it was fun, like I know how to have fun. And it's a lot easier.
Yeah, you do.
It's a lot easier. It's a lot easier than the stuff we do. They're like, this is a lot of work and it's a lot of stress.
Yeah, fun could come
and,
cheaper.
You know,
I know how to have fun too.
There's a lot of things that are not fun.
A lot of times, sometimes it isn't as much fun as we thought it would be.
Yeah, I was wondering when you were going to get honest about that.
I can go ahead. You've been talking about it, but that was the. Couple shots of the spaceship, and for those of you who weren't there, didn't get to see it. And one thing that we do include in all of the events up to date, I think, is I have a pretty heavy focus on audience participation, and we consider the audience to be a very integral part into the work itself. So starting out with the first event, and even we did this in the second event, having when people came in, they had to check in and get photo documentation that they were there and present their object. Then inside, we had photo booths and encouraged people to dress up to be part of this environment. So especially the launch party, we were very much creating this kind of saturation of the concept and the idea of this retro future space theme going on. So. We have a lot of ephemera. We have a lot of documentation. I think a lot of these projects live through that documentation, which is extremely important to everything we do, because we ended up taking the spaceship to the car crusher compactor, had it smashed down into what we thought was going to be a cube, but turned into a pancake.
It was horrible.
It was sad.
Cube is only on.
We had these big containers that had foam insulation. They popped and blew crap went everywhere. It was bad.
Yeah,
but it was
the people at the salvage yard were very nice. They shoveled up all the.
Very
cube.
Nice. Yeah.
But I think like talking about having, you know, we're really focused on having people involved or whatever. At least like for myself and probably for everybody else, that's like what keeps it exciting, you know, because we don't know what people. You know, are going to do, what people are going to show up with, like people like to heckle us, you know, so that's what keeps it interesting, I think, for us. And it gives like the event or show or whatever you want to call it, like a certain energy that you wouldn't get if you were just like, I'm going to go see this thing that I saw a photograph of, like in a catalog or whatever, like, oh, there it is, look at it, you know, it looks pretty much the same.
Colors are different.
Yeah, you don't know what you're going to get as much, so I think that's one reason why maybe people show up.
So. No, I think so too, and I also wonder about your strategy. I mean, the whole kind of psychology of participation, I think is fascinating. And your the way you set it up, like you said, they walk in, they get their picture taken, so it's like they've been seen. You know, it's not, you know how you can be anonymous? You can walk into an opening and be anonymous. You can also feel like you're walking in the middle of something, like, but you're sort of, you had everybody there to sort of walk everybody through it. You had them take pictures with the photo. I mean, you're creating this kind of participation. You've locked them in. You know, it's almost like you know, you're the internet, and you've just gotten all of their information. You know, you know them. You own them in a way. Mm-hmm. And And I think that the fact that you have them bring stuff, can you talk a little bit about that? Like the, you know, I hear what you're saying, Kris, about there's this unknown factor, and I know that that's maybe even more the case when you invited the, you sat back and invited the audience to interact with you, and then you really had to like just take whatever came at you. This one seemed friendlier. Am I right?
Yes. Yeah. We were friendlier.
You were friendlier. Yeah.
You were so young.
I agree. Yeah.
People hadn't wronged us yet.
Yeah. A little less bitter.
But,
yeah.
But about that participation thing, you know, well, and also, if you did you guys think that it would be something after launch party, or did you think this was it? I mean, this was the first.
Well, I don't wanted to be famous, right?
Yeah.
You
wanted to be famous.
No.
Is there a consensus?
Never.
Never.
We did collect items ourselves to have available in the event that people didn't bring items, so we didn't know. It's just part of that not knowing.
We didn't have
and what's plan? Yeah, what's plan B?
You had a lot of crap out back.
But your question was like, do we have anything planned after?
Yeah, you did launch party.
No, we did it, and I think afterwards we were like, well, what do
that
we
was
do?
Good. Yeah.
What do we do?
Again.
That kind of explains the nature of launch party. You did kind of seem like you had nothing to lose, sort of in a way, with that. The element of the guest artist, that's something that's shown up throughout the, and you did that with, you started that with launch party. And also, if somebody could speak to art historical references or bringing in things that if somebody's kind of in the know, they're going to get. Which is another way to bring your to have people participate or feel like they're a part of something.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think it was so much a case of the launch party that we were thinking about that. I think that probably down the road, certainly with Hands on an Art Body and then
Postcom
we were. But for this, you know, we were just thinking about friends that made cool shit that we wanted to bring into the space that seemed fitting. Mm-hmm. You know, so we had Elliot Johnson and M. and Christopher Blay, and then Tim actually made some work for the show, and then Kris Pierce, he did too. Yeah. So we had a mix of like members and sort of invited artists that contributed work to the overall sort of thing.
Which is another way to kind of build, you know, to enlarge your group. I mean, in some ways you're assuring your success, you know, if in fact numbers are important. You've done a lot to sort of ensure that. But I'm thinking about like Jury's office. I thought that was a stroke of genius. Mm-hmm.
That was all Devon.
That was Devon, yeah.
And I mean,
you want to talk about that, Devon?
So Yuri's office was a Rufus Corporation project that was done at Fort Worth Contemporary Arts in, I think, 2010, where another art collective, in a sense, remade the office of Yuri Gagarin, I believe, the first Russian astronaut in space, whose office is in a, I don't know what museum now. I should have studied up a little bit more.
You knew it at the time.
Yeah, I knew it at the time.
It's in there.
But just as that space reference, as an artifact, as a set piece, when that came into the conversation, we thought that that would be the DJ booth. Yeah. So that's what it became. We recreated the recreation of Yuri's office that acted as a DJ booth during the event.
Yeah, that kind
which I really like, because like the Rufus Corporation, what they did was recreate the set based on photographs. So it was actually built to scale, and then like we reflattened it, you know, so it just became this kind of one-to-one thing for something as sort of silly as a DJ set. But,
yeah, but it does invite an audience and recognition that is particularly Fort Worth and mm-hmm. Dallas that experience that exhibition, that have that connection to the work, and that's recognition.
Okay, you wanna
go on?
Yeah, let's see. So that was the ship that left.
Oh, if you can see it, that's just the crowd.
Yeah.
Everyone.
Gives you the sense.
So after this, I don't know, we just started brainstorming again and taking a lot of the elements that we liked about Launch Party and reformatting them. We were in conversation with Kevin Jacobs from Alder Francis Gallery, and we knew we wanted to do something with Kevin. So
this idea, hands on art body, kind of came out of just some thinking. I think Greg and I were doing an art handling job in LA for the Affordable Art Fair.
The Affordable Art Fair.
I think that played into it.
So depressing.
It was really depressing.
The best one.
And so we were talking a lot about the commodification of art and this idea of the blue chip artist. And I don't know, just how we felt about that. Obtaining the object and whether it's worth, is it worth the object or is it worth the monetary value of the object, and how that plays into the art market and how that plays into us as emerging artists. And I just rewatched Hands on a Hard Body, which I don't know who's seen it. It's a great documentary about this competition where they have a hard,
Nissan hard body
Shelby
truck,
has one.
And whoever keeps their hand on the truck the longest wins. So it was very easy just turning that right into a gallery show. So we all, as a collective, all as members, decided what artists we wanted to kind of create unique pieces of work for. So we created our own collection, our own fabricated homecoming blue chip collection of really great artists that's all fabrication. And then invited people to come view it and participate in the competition where they can choose what they want, put their hands on it. Last man standing wins the piece.
And all of the work that was made was very specifically made to either repel or what's the other word?
Attract.
It had that sense of touching.
There was that sense of you either really want to touch it, or you know, you touch it and it might be painful, or you might be in an awkward position holding mm-hmm. onto it, or you might have your hand on someone's fanny yeah. or something.
Yeah. And talking a lot, like Mike Kelly had just passed away when we were talking about this. So one of the pieces was this like half finished Mike Kelly. So it was talking about what was going on in the contemporary art world. We have Martin Creed, Lawrence Weiner.
Thomas Roof.
Richard Prince.
Mm-hmm. So, I mean, a lot of these artists influence our practice as well. So it was a lot of fun to actually have that liberty to be like, I'm going to make a Richard Prince or something mm-hmm. that derives from it. And I think that was pretty enjoyable for us as individual members, and kind of being able to play with that in a very legitimate form where we're not ripping them off, we're kind of paying homage to it. And then having people come in and presenting it in a way that it could legitimately be this like really amazing group show.
Also for it to go away.
Yeah, that's
like we made it and didn't go like into storage or something.
Oh yeah,
it was nice to find a home.
That was a really like kind of sad, but like weird thing about it, because I didn't think that we would get so attached to him, But
I don't
like
even
putting
remember.
So like putting so much work into it, and then I don't know if it was like it wasn't a bad thing, but it was just like a strange thing to just like give it away.
Yeah, and so while this whole thing was going on, we made a huge event out of it. People got like tags, like they were running a marathon, like competing in something.
Yeah.
And we had referees, and we had a guest artist.
Richie Bud was in the crowd. Where are you, Richie? There he is.
And we actually documented it during the thing as a kind of faux documentary, since it was based on this Hands on a Hard Body. So we have, tonight is the first public viewing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Go to the video.
Documentary.
This is why you come to these things. You don't want to miss this stuff. You got the touch.
I just want these chairs. That's all. You've been good to the test, but won his thesis but refuses to let go of it.
What is motivating him to keep your hand in this work?
Oh, just, you know, endurance, and you gotta be out there and give it 110%, and I just see how long I can go.
Definitely 110% right here. Everyone needs to be more like Sterling, is what I'm saying.
Now that you're here and you see it, what are you doing? Harsh words, Terri Thornton.
I just won, dude. I can't believe it. I won the bear.
That's a real mustache, by the way.
I have a couple of things I want to ask you about this project, because I think it was tremendously successful despite some of the images from that video. I think your work is, let's face it, I have you here because I think your work is smart. Greg said that I couldn't go the whole night without saying that, but I do. I just think it's funny, but the most brilliant people on the planet are really good comedians, and I think that that's what you guys have going for you. And I'm interested in a lot of things, and we don't have time for it all, but a couple of things with this project. I'm really interested with this idea of commodification and what you guys seem to be saying about the art world through the work. Again, it's funny, so you can get away with saying it. This is, you know, classic Colbert, Jon Stewart, you know, best news sources on television. You guys are sort of playing that role a little bit with art. And then I also want to ask you a little bit about your guest artist thing. But first of all, I want to read just what you wrote, and whoever writes for you is very good. And I think you guys changed that up, right? It's kind of whoever is sort of
invested. We all sort of work on it together.
You come together and do it. That's.
We pass it around.
That's amazing that you can come to that kind of agreement. There are institutions with editors that wish that.
Yes.
There's blood spilled. It's not totally innocent.
Yeah, well, everybody seems to have survived.
We do seminars for very low cost.
I know some institutions that may sign up for that. It's you write, hands-on and hard body explores the object-viewer relationship. Okay, that's no small thing right there. And evaluates the culture of ownership and value within the context of the art economy, collectors, auctions, and competition. Amplified since the era of mechanical reproduction and modern social connectivity, the art object has enjoyed a level of mythos imbued upon it through insurable values, condition reports, guarded display, and published auction results. This stands to compete with the value of the object's original artistic statement, not often connected to its trophy status and lost in the shadow of its provenance. That's pretty profound. And I know that kind of says it all, but can you elaborate on that? I mean, that's no small stuff. I know you did that over beers, but it's just no small thing that.
I think, like, I mean, I can sort of only speak for myself, but like, you know, like I grew up playing in bands, and you know, like specifically like punk bands, like that was like my culture. That was like the underground scene or whatever that I identified with the most and still do to this day. And the thing that like always made that really important or like special to me was like, there was a stage, but there's not the same line that there is between, you know, between you and like Kanye West or some shit like that. Like if you go see a band, like, you know, a punk band or whatever, like you are on the stage with them and that kind of thing. And there's like, you know, it breaks down some of those barriers. And I think for me, you know, everyone else chime in, whatever.
Sometimes there's not a stage.
But for me, like, this was there's a similar thing in the art world, you know, where ownership to some degree, even with artwork that's cheap, is relegated to people who can afford it. You know, same with, like, the ideas or accessibility to the gallery and that kind of stuff. And I thought what was really special about this project was bringing in some of what I loved about, you know, music or the music culture that I identified with, and trying to like flip the tables in art context or whatever.
Yeah, like a big part of it was we were like, we wanted to make an opportunity for anybody to afford it. Like, we had a big debate of whether we charged people to compete, and we decided not to because that would mean almost literally anybody could walk up, sign up, and compete and have a fair chance at walking away with a piece of artwork. It doesn't matter.
It needed to be based on sheer determination.
Yeah,
right.
It was all just
a commitment to the work.
How much you wanted that piece versus how much you could afford, you know?
And how big your bladder was.
Yeah. That's part of the commitment. Diapers.
It was like a leveling the playing field to where ownership was based on sort of your physical ability as opposed to your monetary, you know, means or whatever.
Thank you for elaborating on that. That seems really important to me with that project, and it says a lot about you guys as a group. The other element is the guest artist concept, and I couldn't help but notice, actually Cam and I were having this conversation, that Richie Budd was your guest artist, and he was like the lifeguard, and he's up on this stand, and he's looking down on the everything that's happening. He also has, you know, he's also, we won't go into it, we'll give him a night to talk about this maybe, but, you know, he's also referencing a performance piece of his own up there. Somebody brought out in some conversation we had that there was sort of this idea because, you know, Good Bad Collective had done this thing that some of you, especially those of you that had gone to North Texas, but you can't live in the area without having known about that, you know, you kind of look to, you. I mean, I'm sure that they occur to you on occasion when you're working out your ideas. And so he's sitting up there as a member of that, of the Good Bad Collective, kind of looking down on this. And then also, wasn't he a professor of some of you at the time? Was he teaching that class at that time?
Not at the time, no.
It was later?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I thought that lined up too. But can you talk about, I mean, is any of that, is that just complete projection?
I didn't really thought about that. I think that at the time we were thinking like, let's put Richie way up in the air because it'd be hilarious. And let's do like a lifeguard type of thing, which we struggled over because it was like, well, how does the lifeguard fit into this whole thing? We're like, ah, oh, fuck it, let's put him in. But
we fall back on that.
Yeah,
but it also like because you said we weren't going to talk about the piece, but he was doing a performance based on a piece he did before where he was mining gold out of Goldschlager. Okay. So he was taking like the valuable metal out of liquor, and then at our event he was handing out the Goldschlager
with the gold.
So it was kind of the same idea of taking away value from something.
Okay, I guess I was projecting that on that, but it made sense to me. It looked like there might be something to that. All right, do you want to talk about some of these individual things? Or
I think we should move
best
on.
Not to.
Okay.
Yeah.
You want to get to the DMA?
Yeah, we're ready for, I think the next one is post communique. And this is when you were coming in, you saw the time lapse. Thank you, time lapse.
Construction and deconstruction.
Right.
The process of it.
So, are we starting with...
Okay. Should we play the video?
It comes next. I think, do you want to just, let's jump in.
Well, yeah. Well, our first...
Show the video.
After working together for about a year and a half, and being invited into a museum to do a project, that we would, I mean, one of the first ideas was that we would have a retrospective. That kind of silly idea like really grew into something that that was more significant, that had a lot more teeth to it,
It was just so obvious when you are invited to a museum and you're a group like us that we're going to do an institutional critique performance. And it all grew out of that institutional critique, and that idea of the retrospective, you know, we automatically were like, well, we've been around for a year and a half. We don't really have a retrospective, so we just make it all up.
Plus, it was like somewhat like cynicism that we were. I mean, it was a wonderful opportunity, obviously, but there was some cynicism on our part, like, you know, like, based on why are we doing this? Based on what? Like a few events we've done. So,
Right. I mean, I think we were very lucky and, flattered to be given that invitation, but us ourselves were still like, oh, what are we doing here?
I don't know how much time, but like we had one project proposed, and then it didn't really work out, and they were like, well, come up with something. And then we were kind of like, well, what can we do that is like,
how can we really piss
how
them
can
off?
We really piss them off? Or like, this could be something that like they would never let us do. Yeah. And then they're like, this is a great idea, you should do this. Yeah. And shot ourselves in the foot. And, like,
to their credit, right?
Yeah, I'm really happy with that $1 million, so.
I wasn't quite sure how you wanted to do this, because I do want to talk a little bit about moving from these things that you initiated yourself and then getting an invitation that really changes the game. Mm-hmm. I mean, for somebody to invite you to do something, everything's different. It's just different. There's no way. This is so far from launch party in a way, although you'll see some of the same themes coming through. Something that you've done consistently is promote these things beautifully. Obviously, you have a real skill for promoting these things, and you've done trailers and such. So do you want to show the trailer first, mm-hmm. so that kind of to give people prior to coming to this, number one, to pique their interest, to excite them, but also to set the stage, like this is what you're in for.
Okay. So. We can watch this and then talk about what it means or
doesn't.
Girls,
you're looking really good.
Tonight I'll be a bundle of joy.
What were you saying with that?
We're dangerous.
You're dangerous.
I
don't know. I think that everybody has to take like the opportunity to like introduce ourselves to a larger Dallas audience, you know, at the DMA, as like totally messing with all notions of who we were, you know. So largely, I think we were just thinking about like fabricating kind of history and mixing up fact and fiction and placing ourselves in a false timeline, And I guess with the video, you know, I don't know, like with a lot of things, like the promotional stuff, like songs sort of like build the video, you know, and so like, I don't know, I was shuffling through things and like this Gigi Allen song came up and I was like, shit, that's it, yeah, I've got to use that. Mm-hmm. But a lot of it was just like, you know, it's thieves of history or like, you know, like these espionage sort of characters.
And a lot of like this inspired by like counterculture movements, a lot of in the 60s, and we were kind of going through that whole like underground grassroots kind of concept that it doesn't really seem to exist anymore. I don't know, it's very like very aggressive.
Need to bring it back.
Yeah.
Plus I think we were like starting, we were trying to establish the idea that we were like manipulating or starting to build this, fabricate this idea or this like reality of what this show is going to be, and it was just the sort of the device that we used to launch that idea.
And especially the fact that there was a legitimate 50-year historical show about what had been happening in Dallas. And the same museum, of course, we are going to elevate ourselves above that. Or you know, you guys were playing these ones, you know, having that year fun and games, and we were doing this. And,
so serious.
The Dallas sites.
So your time frame really referred back to Dallas sites. I don't know if everybody knows about Dallas. Last summer had this show, Dallas Sites, which was sort of this historical presentation of what had happened in Dallas in the art world, and then Available Space became the current version of what's going on. Homecoming was invited to be a part of that and really blew it out of the water. I mean, people were stunned. I mean, I think the emotions ranged from just being blown away by how great it was to being incredibly jealous that they'd pulled this thing off, you know.
I think like, I don't know if I'm getting too far ahead, but like I think there's something that we should sort of talk about that people that went to the show necessarily wouldn't know, and it's really like this sort of arc of control that we attempted to create throughout the exhibition. Like for anybody that went to the exhibition, on the opening night we in sort of a calculated way resigned control over ourselves over to the audience. And we had this like button that people could ask us a question. They would just push this button and we'd stop what we were doing or whatever. So it was this cycle where we resigned control over the viewer in the beginning, and then slowly started to turn like the vice on that. And by the end, we had a 12 course dinner that completely excluded the viewer. They were behind stanchions, and they couldn't participate. And what that was really meant to do was to sort of like show the power of the institution and the artist's hand, like in controlling what happens in the institution. And that was like a very calculated thing that people wouldn't necessarily pick up on, but that we had in mind, like, you know, with the exhibition.
Yeah, so, and throughout the show, what we've done is we basically built this kind of facility of our own, like a headquarters, post-communique kind of. Is where it kind of came from. It's like, this is our station for us to create our lies and our kind of our false history. So what we also did was we created artworks that referenced our false history of things, of us saying like, oh, this happened when we hung out with this famous artist, and this is an artwork we made that inspired this artist and kind of created this entire false history, and made labels that mimicked and imitated all the labels throughout the rest of the museum. So any viewer who walked in not knowing what they were experiencing would read these labels and be like, wow, these people have been around for this long, and this is, you know, and it's so, like, it was shocked, like how many people believed it.
Yeah. Especially because
the majority,
many of us were in the space almost every day. Any day that you went to the museum, there'd be at least two or three of us there
to lie to you.
And they still believed that we were, you know.
Yeah, we gave tours.
You were still.
Like, we actually gave tours a couple times.
Mm-hmm. But I mean, for myself personally, I started out the month, I think, reluctantly participating in the lie, and then I learned how to manipulate it a little bit. And I ended up, you know, you prompt people with questions that they, once they start realizing what we're doing, it's really, yeah, really
and
it's
starting to you break soul. Down you break different. Down that barrier a little bit, and the once people start to understand what you're doing and why you're doing it, you can just see their eyes kind of light up and like everything clicks and the cogs are turning. And it's a kind of a gratifying moment as an artist to see that moment of realization of what you're trying to put into a public view, a public audience, and it's actually creating that conversation. It works. You can, I don't know, it's a very tangible moment.
Tim, you have to tell the 1961 story, or 1967 story.
Yeah, I mean, of all the wonderful interactions that occurred during that month, I mean, there was one instance where there was, you know, sweet grandmother bringing her young son or grandson to the museum and doing, as a good teacher should do, reading the cards and explaining to this young man what he was looking at. And I made a Solowit wall drawing inspired instructions that described our facility and how it ended up there. And so she read it, and then she proceeded to walk over to myself and another member who were hanging out. She said, "So is this a traveling show? Is this has been here since 1964, correct?" And I couldn't lie to her, so I said, "Yes, of course. This has been here since 1964." And you know, so I can only hope that really the cycle will truly be complete in 10 to 15 years. That child is in their first college level art class, and Solowit comes up, and they say, "I'm sorry, homecoming committee did that." Found to happen.
And it was, yeah, it was shocking how much people believed it. And like, because like we tried to make it seem somewhat realistic, but there was always something that that was there to kind of give it away. Like the football was signed by the Japanese
Saburo Murakami, yeah, who was part of the Gatai movement.
Yeah, and we were saying, like, we took him to a football game, and he saw the football team walk through the banner and inspired this piece where he walked through a piece of paper. And the football has a Nike logo on it. And Nike wasn't around until, like, the late 80s.
But you had 70s. A few sleuths that came through. And
yeah, someone pointed that out.
And that's what kind of made it gratifying, was seeing people kind of...
to actually see people thinking instead of just reading art. So people were thinking about art, and the experience of it being gratifying for somebody to see the light bulb. I mean, as artists, you put things out there, and you rarely actually see that moment when somebody has an experience with your work, right?
Yeah, and going back to what Kris was talking about, like the evolution of the project and how we kind of came to the dinner towards the end, that was not like preconceived. It was really based on sort of the experiences we had, and we I guess, like, you know, talking about prior projects, when we were surprised by the results and sort of like surprised by the kind of evolution of the project, this was like a whole nother animal. Like, it really kind of messed us up, you know, in a way that we had no way of predicting. And so, like, the opening night that we sort of let the crowd control us, and we were all like sort of exhausted by finishing the installation, and then it came time when we were finishing it, like Bradley says, up to the point of these football players coming through the paper, and we spent the next 5-6 hours like in being like
rats in a cage.
Yeah, I mean, it was like
exhausting.
The only time that we all left
We had these conversations before the opening of how we're going to create this environment that is a bit abrasive to the audience. There were like, you know, 20 videos, or I don't know how many videos, 10 videos playing, and there's lots of noise and lots of stimulation and visuals everywhere. And we're like, yeah, it's going to totally mess with the audience, you know, they're going to be overwhelmed. And they can come and go as they please. We were the ones who were stuck there. So throughout the night, we all started going a little crazy.
Yeah.
And I think it was that overstimulation. And then realizing that we just handed the audience complete control.
Yep. Except for that little line of tape.
That they wouldn't. It's amazing. You put tape on the ground.
But then it got later, and people got drunker and meaner.
Yeah, it started like heckling almost, and the point where so now they have this little toy up here that they could control us with. They push that button,
and you can
and
see
we
that.
Have to come down there.
Yeah. Yeah. It's obnoxious.
Well, and the thing that like that was the thing is like we didn't really think about is like there was, you know, we would go into the space, we would really be committed for like the whole day, which was 8 hours or whatever it was. And there was really kind of nowhere to escape to. Mm-hmm. You were kind of like on in sort of presentation mode the whole time. And now it's like a really strange feeling because people, for some reason, when you're in a gallery or you're, you know, quote unquote performing or in the public space or whatever, they feel like they have license to interact with you in a certain way or to like do things to you or to, you're suddenly sort of taken out of like this normal human, you know, like I'm a person, don't do this to me kind of situation. And like now like I'm a monkey and you can do whatever you want, you know, because we're in this context. And that was like a really kind of strange, hard thing to deal with. And like as the thing progressed, it just got more and more difficult. So it was like, it was part like, it sort of worked with this like arc that we decided, you know, in the end where we were reclaiming control over our own presence in the space, you know, with this dinner that was closed off and people weren't invited to participate in it.
I think it's important to also, I think a lot of you probably experienced this, but for anybody who didn't, this was so thick with psychology of controlling the audience okay, there's paper over the door. The football players bust through the paper. Then, and you know, everybody's standing outside waiting in anticipation. The artists are inside, kind of in this privileged situation. They have the table set like this, except you expect this tonight, across the space, which set them apart from the audience. So again, that kind of operates like that paper. And people were aggressive. I mean, people that know them as people, as art, you know, individual artists, and you know, rightfully so. That's kind of what they were inviting. It made for a very interesting night. But then, throughout the exhibition, they turned that table so that it was perpendicular to the entrance, inviting people in. Whole different dynamic. Now, it wasn't that night. People weren't drinking in the museum like they do one night a month at the DMA. You may want to put that on your calendar. but, you know, I was so struck with that, and it was so inviting that, you know, it made me want to go and hang out there. I wanted to meet people there to talk, you know, whereas I might otherwise want to go and have a cup of coffee. I was like, can we just go down and sit in that space at that table? And to me, too, then something I want you to address, I know we're tight on time here, but I want somebody to talk about this. You've thrown out the model of the band, and I do, that's how I always think about you guys operating, sort of under the model of the band, and certainly up to this point. Like, you know, you all are there, everybody's kind of equal, you're throwing out ideas, whatever. This seemed like it took on the model of the think tank more than the band. Does that make sense, or does that ring true?
I think that it was, I mean, this was kind of running parallel to the ideas of the MacGuffin, which we can, I guess if we have time, we can get into
yeah,
afterward.
We're going
but we had this idea of the MacGuffin project, which was largely based on that brainchild that of the studio time, of the like drinking, hanging out and having fun and like, you know, the stewing pot of all these ideas. And I think that, though we proposed that before the DMA project, as the DMA project was evolving, I think that was all in the back of our minds, though it was kind of a different construct. It was this totally sort of like hardline political kind of thing that the MacGuffin became something completely different. But I think the structure of the table certainly was built out of this what is it, 5x5 square table that we have in our studio that we'd all sit around every day or every other day. So.
Yeah, I love that. Even on the website, the graphic, if you go to their website, the graphic for that is like this table. That's the graphic for Post Communique. And their chairs are like tossed over. And, you know, it's I think it's kind of clever. This is interesting that you went from, and I'm glad you clarified that MacGuffin was an idea before Post Communique, but it's just too sweet that it happens on the heels of, and I know there's some other things in between, but it happens basically on the heels of Post Communique, because I do think you guys were a little weary, you know, a little worn after Post Communique. That was a demanding piece or project. So MacGuffin sort of feels like, what I noted was kind of ironically, because MacGuffin, and you need to explain what a MacGuffin is, but a but it has sort of this, it's tied to a plot or a story. But in this case, this is the one time or the first time that I can see that you haven't sort of created a narrative for the space. You left it much more open. Can you talk a little bit about what a MacGuffin is and how that relates to the way you set up this project?
You want to take that?
So a MacGuffin is a cinematic and literary device that is used to initiate a narrative, initiate a story. So one of the things, Maltese Falcon is a great example of a MacGuffin. The one I always go to is Indiana Jones, and that first scene when he grabs the idol and switches it out and starts the big boulder. That idol's a MacGuffin. It's an object of desire by the protagonist who wants to claim it, and it starts the action.
The money in Psycho, which
right.
Hitchcock sort of popularized the term.
Mm-hmm. But then it's never really referenced again throughout the rest of the narrative. So it starts that action, starts that storyline, but kind of disappears. So a very significant object that loses its significance very quickly. So for this, our MacGuffin initially became, we came to the gallery and we wanted to put a hot tub in the gallery and just kind of build the space.
They said yes.
And I want to just insert here, they is another artist who living in Fort Worth, and I happen to think that Fort Worth is like every other place on the planet. We're all just trying to make life interesting. And to do that, she actually started this alternative space with her team of artists / curators. And so that's why they found somebody agreeable with putting the hot tub in a space, because...
So this show is at Andex, which is kind of by Montgomery and 30. Great location and perfect for this project. But we weren't really planning too much of what was going to happen after we put this MacGuffin into the space. We built it out a little bit, and then just wanted to see what was going to develop from our interactions, kind of bringing our studio practice into a public arena, inviting the public to participate in this narrative with us. So it was trying to create a series of events.
And you're back to the band model here, very much.
Literally,
right?
Literally.
Like it becomes the form, not just the model.
Music played a big role in this project, I think, for some of us. And we spent a lot of time creating this very repetitive soundtrack to the event that would get played. There was a lot of audio going on with it. Even when you walk in the room, there was these. Kind of animalistic
monkey sounds
in the front room that we made ourselves, but it kind of that
we should have played those.
You can hear them in the video in the back. But yeah, it's this animalistic, very
jungle room.
I mean, where we come from as creatives, that core sense of creativity to me, you know, very in the bubbling ether of life and creation, and where that comes from. But we had a noodle tube for the beginning and turned it into a group. It was a group meal.
It has a real name.
Filled up the water from the tube filled up the hot tub. So everyone participated in eating these noodles that we were making. As we dropped them down the tube, you had to grab them with chopsticks. And then the runoff went into a pump system that ended up filling up the hot tub. So everyone's participating in the filling of this big artistic soup. Hot tub, gross mess of bubbles.
And as it fills, the music builds to crescendo.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah, as the night goes on, we're playing, I think we ended up playing for an hour and a half.
Yeah,
solid.
The same song.
Yeah, Shelby.
Yeah.
And that brings us to another thing that I always like to talk about is so many of our events have this endurance element to them. Even like all the way from hands-on art body, which was purely based on endurance, but like there's always these reoccurring elements, even with post-communicate, just that devotion of having to be there all the time, and the interaction became an endurance. And then playing music for an hour and a half is not very easy. It's a lot of fun, but it is just like endurance.
Especially when it's the same song.
Same like three chords.
Same guitar riff.
Same four notes.
So this first event was this kind of launching of the space and public interaction with this meal, communal meal.
This piece seems like to me it's very internal. Like you guys have, it's almost like therapeutic. I said that the other night when we were meeting and nobody bought it, but it just feels like you're going, you know, inside. Like you've been so public, you've been so out there, you've been pretending to be something you're not, and it's like time to come back home or something.
Well, I think the idea was to sort of present, I don't know, like the dynamic of our meetings or whatever when we get together to kind of conceptualize ideas and stuff like that, and have that organically grow and evolve in a gallery space. And I don't know if it's possible to do that.
Because
honestly, like that's sort
of maintaining
it.
It's not
possible. To maintain it over and sort of present that to people. And I think that's maybe the conclusion that we came to in the end. It's like we haven't really figured out how to make that happen or make that interesting or whatever. Maybe it's not interesting.
Well, maybe it's not that interesting, you know? Yeah. I mean, maybe that's the case, is that actual interaction. It's interesting when it's like to an end, but as an activity itself, that's really real life. Everything else kind of up to this point has had sort of this artifice to it that makes it exciting. And
plus the whole show was, you could log in and view the space online 24 hours a day. So every time we were in there, I think, I don't personally, for me, there was always this weird feeling that someone's watching you, even though I knew no one was.
Yeah. Or like, we probably watched them watching.
I was just hoping, right.
But you yeah, so it felt so unnatural, and you had to kind of, it wasn't that free space that we were used to in the studio. Mm-hmm. It was, you know, we had to be thinking about who's watching us and what they're doing. And I would get like text messages like from someone like looking for a tool or a hammer, then Kris would be like, it's behind you.
I think I could buy the therapeutic thing a little bit though. And just after the DMA experience, and then we really just wanted to get that hot tub working and hang out in the hot tub.
I think the idea would was therapeutic, mm-hmm. but unfortunately, it became very frustrating.
Mm-hmm. But a lot of it comes down to the duration too, like that endurance that mm-hmm. happens over a long time, which is like, even though we gained a lot from the DMA experience, it's like, God, we got to do this again and again and again and again. But I thought that the MacGuffin for the opening was a great success, but then, you know.
But just like anything, it turned into something else. Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Plus the weather.
It's not been our friend.
It was the ice. Yeah.
But I think that the way this is set up, like there's an element of anxiety for you walking in the door, this kind of false paradise, and then you have everybody perform this really anxiety-ridden task that you're going to tell us about. And then you walk into the noodle tube, as we're now calling it officially, and you know, you have this camaraderie of eating together. I mean, you just still, like, even though it's sort of open, all of your layers are there again.
Mm-hmm. And I think one of the most successful things to come out of this, we can all show it real quick, is the audience participation element again. And that second event we did with the blow-to-pop videos, where before you entered the space, or during the space, you had to blow up a balloon until it popped in your face, and then we videotaped them. And it's making that anxiety again. Like, the mm-hmm. whole idea of that is, like, you're blowing and you're blowing, you're blowing, you're getting bigger and bigger, and you're waiting for something to happen, and you're waiting for something to explode. So, yeah, it builds up in you, and then it happens, and it's released, and you actually can relax. And I think that's kind of the mentality of the show. I mean, it's called Blow to Pop.
We know what that is, yeah.
Just wait till the last video.
We'll get to that.
Mm. Mm-hmm. Hit play.
This isn't the anxiety building.
It is for us.
It is for us.
There we go.
Oh.
No.
Oh.
Oh. Oh. Okay. I'll let John do it.
Thank you, John.
Changing hairdos.
I think that sums up that show.
Your final project that we're going to present tonight is your most recent, The Eagle Has Landed. And I think that what's interesting to me is moving from MacGuffin being this kind of, as I perceive it, a more private space, a kind of internalizing. And then to go out and even there is a public element, but it's a virtual kind of, you know, with the surveillance. And then to go out in real physical space and to introduce something and interact with a public in kind of on their own turf with The Eagle Has Landed. So you guys want to talk? I know this grew out of a conversation I think you had with.
This was another project that we began, I think, in the fall, late 2012, before the DMA invited us, before the biennial happened.
And it's been in the works for like a year.
Yeah, and we were looking, it grew out of us looking for a location downtown to do a project, and something that I think happens a lot in our conversations is reflecting on the space and making an event really talk about the history of a place and how it affects the space. And we were offered Burnett Park as a location that would be a really great, you know, downtown location to do an event. And this idea of recreating the Eagle, which was, as most of you probably know, a Calder sculpture that was downtown from 1974 to 1999. And there was some discussion when it left about the value of art in public places and whether or not that's privately owned or how public funds have to play in that. They kind of developed a Fort Worth public art project. And that was something that I just really latched onto and got excited about. And this happened last week, so we haven't had any moment to debrief about it. We haven't talked about it, so. Yeah, but it was really taking this project out into the city and seeing, you know, what was hoped for, but what was not fully anticipated, the amount of people that wanted to take pictures of it, selfies with it, post it and repost it. So we did, we're lovingly calling this our homecoming sweatshop, because we did, a lot of people asked us, you know, where we had it fabricated, but we did make it ourselves. And
with the help of friends.
Mm-hmm. Yes, with a lot of people from outside of the group as well that really contributed an amazing amount of support for the project.
Can you talk about each of the sites and how you chose them, or just generally even?
A lot of the sites were kind of just based around this Burnett Plaza being the center, and mm-hmm. we kind of created like this kind of idea of the Eagles moving towards downtown from different directions. So each day it was coming in from the north, and another day it was coming from the west and the south, and its final result would be in downtown Fort Worth. But mm-hmm. As far as that goes, and a lot of it was kind of dealt with who wanted to work with us and thought that this was an important project too.
Right. So. Yeah, you had to, again, you were seeking permission and self-initiation.
It was a mixture also. I mean, we had some people that we did collaborate with for to show it, but we did a lot of pop-ups too, like Blue Bonnet Circle. We just kind of showed up and mm-hmm. popped it up there. And so I think that was kind of a nice element as well. But there are a few other institutions that we got to team up with and wanted to make sure we got it throughout the city. So going to places we normally aren't necessarily interacting with and bringing something like this, you get a lot of differing audiences and differing opinions. And this, to me, this whole project was so much about creating that conversation and kind of spurring that some of those ideas on, just kind of seeing what happens and seeing what people talk about. Mm-hmm. I think we got a lot of good conversation came out of it online and face to face.
Well, what strikes me is going back to your earlier point, Kris, where you were talking about, you know, you're here in Fort Worth, you know, how do you make this meaningful, this experience? What does it mean to be in Fort Worth? And I think that in a way you were sort of inviting the public to start asking those questions with this piece. And like Devon said, Calder's Eagle being removed actually is responsible in many ways for there being a public arts program in Fort Worth. So it's no small thing. And, you know, we all see cities that have amazing art, and then we see cities that don't seem to invest in that. And I think that this has started a conversation, at least I've heard a lot of conversation about, you know, really, as citizens of Fort Worth, what do we want to say about ourselves with the art?
And Calder's are almost like an iconic image. The big, ugly red sculptures.
Yeah.
And like everybody.
It's like he was the originator. If you can't make it good, make it big. If you can't make it good. But I say that in a very endearing way. He did it better than anybody else. And everybody else was just an imitator of Calder.
There was this random coincidence with the last spot was Burnett Park. And if, you know, it left downtown area in 99. And I don't know when the silhouette business guy got put in. But that was the return of a monumental sculpture coming into the downtown area.
That's Jonathan Borofsky's piece.
Yes, and sorry. Yeah. But but it was kind of a weird coincidence that it's the last spot that it landed was in the same place as the first return of a monumental piece.
Right, which again is privately owned.
That was a surprise, I guess. I think initially when we discussed the project with people that, you know, when we were looking for locations, and it was clear that this still had a lot of conversations that could happen around it. And I thought that the fact that it was privately owned was part of the contention. But through the conversations with the piece, I've kind of come to the conclusion that it's going to be just as much, you know, continued and more so a matter of private people to bring art, you know, significant works of art in public places here, that, you know, we can't really rely on city funding to accomplish that.
Yeah, if we all agree that those are the circumstances we want to live under, or we could actually all become incredibly involved in our communities and care about our environments and just not accept it, you know, say that we want, you know.
Well, and I wanted to do this also because I was invited to come when the city was going to be, well, when they, you know, decreased the Arts Council funding for 5 years in a row and have now decreased the public art funding. I did have the opportunity to go up and speak in front of council, and like I just figured that I would like put my heart out there and I'd be heartbroken. They'd cut it anyway. I would feel terrible. So this was my response. Like that's what I was doing this for. Was I couldn't, you know, go speak to council. So I'll just like.
Well, I was gonna say I don't think that the form of the Calder is lost on anybody. I do know that this is still new and that you're still processing it, and I appreciate you being willing to close with it as it's the last project tonight. It's gotten really good response from Fort Worth community. It's been written about a lot, and I think the conversation has started. So we'll wait and see what happens, but I suspect that this is going to initiate some change. I really do. I believe that can happen. I'm going to stop short of asking what's coming next, so I can leave that to the Q&A. We probably have about 10 minutes for a Q&A. I want no pressure, but please keep your questions very thoughtful and just long enough that you get to ask what you want to ask so that more people have time to do it. And in typical Tuesday evening fashion, I'm going to begin the Q&A by asking Alden and Briana Williams, what it's been like for you, because the Alden and Briana are very smart undergraduate students at TCU. I mean, they are smart, but they're also very smart in that they position themselves. They're hard workers. They position themselves. They kept hanging out around these guys. They kind of heard the conversations. And my perception is that they very quietly sit back and they're taking it all in, and someday they're going to take over the world. So I would like to know, because you began as audience members and then you became participants, members in the group. So let's start with you, Alden. What's your experience with that been? And then we'll get to you, Briana.
Well, I guess our professor Cam, he you guys need to go to this event, it's going to be super cool, and it was like the launch party. And so, I was like, okay, go to gallery, do my duty. And we brought Christmas lights, I think, as a junk item. And so we went there, and it was very different from any opening I'd been to. And so, they took a picture and stuff, and I fell in love with Homecoming's works after that, and always went to each show that I could, Hands on Art Body. We actually won a couple of pieces.
Wow, what did you win?
We won the Candyman. We call him Candyman.
Based on Felix Gonzalez Torres.
Yeah, and also the hands, they're these plaster hands that hang.
Was that Kiki
Snowman?
Yeah. Okay.
So, we won those two pieces. So we
were good work. Super, that's great. Those are good things to have in the collection.
Yeah, we were super excited. Our parents, maybe not so much. and then I think it was around DMA, Devin and Bradley both kind of asked if we wanted to help out with, building the structure. And we're like, yeah, sounds awesome, And it's really been great being a part of it, and seeing how things come together and unfold, because before being a fan, it's wow, they're just amazing. I put all this stuff together, and then being behind the scenes now, it's wow, this is a lot of work, and
yeah,
so pretty or fun.
Yeah. So much.
Yeah, so it's been a great experience, and learn a lot.
So groupies, it became members of the band. What's been your
wow.
Yeah, I just remember hearing about the launch party from the grad students and also from professors, and I was really excited about it. I think I actually helped put some money in for the Kickstarter, and it covered my ticket, and I also brought stuff too. And it was really exciting. It was a really different format from normal gallery settings, instead of just walking around trying to pretend to you look at the art pieces and you're like, cool, and you're just looking around at other people talking, you're like, yeah. And then this was way more inviting, where you participate and you can start in conversations with people. And it was almost addictive or something, a competition, but you also made friends, sort of, and it was an experience that you could talk about afterwards that was really rewarding. It was the same thing with Hands on Art Body. And then once we were invited, we were really excited, because it's you go from being able to watch all this to getting to be behind the scenes working on all of it. And it was a lot of hard work, but it was also tons of fun, getting to build that huge structure and kind of be part of all the humor and everything.
Has it impacted your work, individual work?
Yeah, I've actually, I'm trying to do more interactive works now, except it's more I let kind of my artwork do more of the interaction. So I'm really more used to, I wasn't really interested in viewer being a participant. Mm-hmm. But now for me, I'm more interested in using that.
There you go. Okay, questions? Comments?
Everyone wants to go home.
You said 8:30.
Yes, sir.
So can you talk about the uniforms that y'all had at the DNA? What was the evolution of that? Because I thought the uniforms were great, especially when I would see people come in, have the uniforms, change into it, and it was a transformation that you went from being just trying to be up, trying to
average person to being an artist or part of the team?
I think that, I mean, we went through a lot of discussion and variations on what those were going to be, but I think we just sort of landed on something that was as sort of ubiquitous and sort of institutional and sort of militaristic as possible.
Yeah, I think like, because, I don't know, there's sort of just this trend, like, you know, I don't know, just sort of like a visual trend in art right now, and it's just like, bright, whatever, the internet's hip, this sort of thing, whatever. And we, does that make sense? And we wanted to be
perfect kind of sense.
Like, you know what I'm saying? Just like Lisa Frank, whatever. We wanted to be the opposite of that. We just wanted to be really kind of paramilitary, intimidating, black and white, and be, you know, like an answer to that sort of aesthetic. And I think we suffer from that a little bit too, like this sort of camp or whatever. Mm-hmm. And we initially, I think, wanted to be a lot meaner than we were.
You don't have it in you.
So it was, I think it was like a response to that.
And we became more and more lax with wearing these military
uniforms. Well, you did.
Uniforms. some of us
bonus
did.
Attention. Okay. Yes, sir.
So you guys operate as a collective, and you are full in this, and you sort of present everything as a cohesive front as homecoming. Is there a specific drive and everything like that to sort of erase the individual identity as sort of a response to maybe like modern art, just like superstar artists and, you know, stuff like that, or as like a reaction to not always having your work or you in the forefront of everything you do? Was the DMA piece sort of a response to that in a way?
Go ahead.
With the launch party, we actually we had pseudonyms, so it was erasing that kind of trail that you could follow back to the individual artist. And then part of the militant uniform, that also erased a certain aspect of individuality with all of us. We were all dressed the same. We operated in the same way for the most part until being mean got exhausting.
I think that's a common thing we have a lot, is just kind of getting rid of that mythos of the artist, of this struggled, depressed addict who is making things, and this is a starving artist kind of thing. We're trying to get away from that, like, oh, just because it's this one person, it's this kind of, I can't sound like the wrong words. It's just kind of the mythos of like the artist, as far as a creator or.
I mean, we're all there. I mean, we're all in there. Mm-hmm. But I think that there's a lot of discussion around like, how does it fit into the larger picture? The piece that we didn't talk about in the DMA, the post-communique piece that was actually based on a kind of hybrid of High Red Center's adaptation of the exclamation point and Klaus Oldenburg's collection of the ray gun, we all sort of collected these amassed exclamation points that were in the explanation of them, the sort of reversal of the I, you know, the I, the individual, the I, everything that we seem to have now. So thanks, Apple. But but I don't know. I think that like we manage it. You know, we manage ego. We all have them, and it can be tough sometimes. And it, you know, I mean, but I think it's worth it in the end. You know,
this actually may be the first event where all of our names have been listed.
Yeah.
I'm just putting that.